morning, destroyers of men's souls. It is I, your faithful home defender, Carrie Nation. You have not heard of me? How can this be? I was born November 25th, 1846, in Girard County, Kentucky, and was part of the temperance movement of the late 1800s. My fellow temperance workers and I entered saloons with hatchets and rocks, smashers I called them, and destroyed the saloons, smashing the alcohol and threatening anyone inside. We felt that alcohol was a promoter of prostitution, family abandonment, and crime. My temperance work began. My husband, Dr. Charles Floyd, died due to alcoholism. I decided I did not want anyone else to meet this horrible, dreadful fate as well, and wanted to stop the spread of the demon drink. But how? My decision was to raid saloons around Kansas, where we had moved, with the hopes that my raids would lessen the number of people drinking and the number of saloons. Felt that if there was no alcohol, there would be no poverty due to people who waste their money on such luxuries. I also began a branch of one of the major temperance groups, the Women's Christian Temperance Union, within Kansas. My personal role, and that of the unions, was to start a national alcohol prohibition in America. In the efforts of starting this prohibition, we were aided by the Anti-Saloon League of 1895. Now, the idea of a prohibition had been presented numerous times in the 1850s. But state legislatures repealed such laws in 1855 through 1865. However, due to my incredible work with the prohibition, Kansas became the first state to enact a statewide alcohol prohibition. This led to less alcohol-related deaths, and workers showing up to work on Monday mornings with clear eyes and steady hands. These same workers also had more money to spend, with none being spent on alcohol. Kansas's prohibition was also responsible for the prosperity of the state. In my eyes, I had become a bulldog, running at the feet of Jesus, barking at what he does not like. Prohibition was our savior, and it was I who had summoned him. I could not believe those wet people who said that a prohibition was a bad idea. Clearly, a prohibition would stop drinking and bring morality to our country. Prohibition was the debate of the century, and there was no way to reach an agreement. It was either prohibition or corruption. Well, I must be off. There are always more saloons to smash. Good day. You got a nice acid. I mean, that was a compliment. Believe me. Those were fighting words in my day that led me to get 3 slash marks across my left cheek. That's why they call me Scarface. Still don't know who I am? I'm Matt Capone, Italian-American gangster. Born January 17th, 1899 in Brooklyn, New York, Alphonse Gabriel Capone. I was the one who, during the Prohibition, sold the illegal booze and made the money. I also organized the St. Valentine's Day Massacre on February 14th, 1929, which is planned as a way to kill my enemy, Bugs Moran. I killed or arranged the killing of some 500 people in my lifetime, mostly during the Prohibition, when it was kill or be killed. The Prohibition induced a ton of crime. So if people weren't drinking alcohol, they were selling it on the highly competitive black market. Now, with all the moonshiners, rum runners, and bootleggers in the world, it was definitely a difficult business. Moonshiners would make the alcohol, rum runners would either smuggle it into the country or from city to city, and bootleggers would get it to the people. Bootlegging was my job. Now, America didn't always have a prohibition. Prohibition was suggested numerous times in the 1850s, but was never strongly considered. But after much pressure from groups like the Anti-Saloon League and the Women's Christian Temperance Union, an act, the Volstead Act, was proposed, to be known as the 18th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution. This stated, after 1 year from the ratification of this article, manufacture, sale, and transportation of intoxicating liquors within, the importation thereof into, or the exportation thereof in the United States and all territories subject to the jurisdiction thereof for beverage purposes is hereby prohibited. This law, if ratified into the U.S. Constitution, would prohibit alcohol. A couldn't believe this. Who in America thought it was a good idea to ban alcohol? Figured this law would come and go as many do and be forgotten as it had many times before. But no. Immediately, many states ratified this law. Nebraska was the 36th state to do so, meaning that we now had the necessary 2/3 of the country on board with this prohibition idea. So it was ratified January 16th of 1919. And just as it stated, prohibition began January 1st of 1920. Of course, with any law, there had to be consequences. First time offenders of the Volstead Act were charged a $1,000 fine and or 6-month jail term. And second time offenders were charged a $10,000 fine and or 5-year jail term. And to help with the catching of those of us who like to break the law, there was the Prohibition Enforcement Agency. It was set in a 6-year period. 10,000 different men held the agency's 3,000 different jobs. They said it was too difficult, if not impossible, to enforce the Volstead Act. However, prohibition-related violations accounted for 65% of all federal court cases. By 1926, there were 96,000 inmates in federal prison, and the good majority of them were locked up due to the prohibition. So, can't say they were catching people, but they sure were stopping the spread of alcohol. In 1929, there were 100,000 speakeasy clubs in New York alone. A speakeasy was a place to dance, drink, and more importantly, hide your activities from the law. Alcohol even made its way into the White House during President Harding's administration. But such incidents were great for us gangsters. We'd make alliances with politicians, basically stating that if you keep us from getting arrested, we'll keep you supplied with alcohol. But if prohibition had been a good idea, the president would have gone against it. As far as getting this alcohol, rum fleets, filled with rum from Europe, appeared in the Atlantic Harbor soon after the prohibition began. As many as 16 ships would lie anchored just outside of U.S. waters, and smaller boats would come boating in the alcohol to us gangsters, where we'd be waiting to take it away to the people. But if people thought this prohibition would make people be more moral, boy, were they wrong. Now, not only were people going out and getting drunk, they were getting drunk and breaking the law. Obviously, the prohibition was causing a lot more problems than it was solving. So, in early 1929, President Hoover assigned 10 men, 1 woman, to study the prohibition enforcement problem. This would be known as the Wickersham Commission, which was submitted in 1931. This read that 5 of the 11 members believed the 18th Amendment should be left alone as it is, 2 of the 11 believed it should be repealed altogether, and 4 of the 11 believed it should be modified. By now, however, everyone realized what a ridiculous idea this prohibition had been. So in 1933, Congress passed the 21st Amendment, which would repeal the 18th Amendment and the Prohibition. New states ratified this as well, with Utah being the 36th state to do so. Once again, we had the necessary 2/3, and Prohibition ended on December 5th of 1933. Was Prohibition a debate? More than anything I'd ever seen. It wasn't one of those things where the moral answer was obvious. On one hand, you had people that believed that Prohibition would stop prostitution, gambling, drinking, of course, and a lot of other crimes. On the other hand, it was said to prompt escalating divorce rates, increased immorality, and a lot of other crimes. This was a debate that raged from the late 1880s into the early 1930s. But as I always said, prohibition has made nothing but trouble. Now if you'll excuse me, I've got some alcohol to deliver. Yeah.
How did you decide upon your clothing changes to go with the characters?
How did I decide what clothing I was going to use?
Mm-hmm. Yes, you know, you had the trench coat representing like Al Capone, and then you started off very considerate in the essay, you know, this is the Agita. What made you decide what process did you go through?
To decide on the clothing? Mm-hmm. Well, I had the trench coat from last year for my history project from then. And I felt it really fit Al Capone as, you know, a large gangster, and this hat I had too. So I just felt that that was very fitting. And this dress and the boots would go with both characters was my ideas. Because Carrie was kind of big and scary, and Al was just a fat gangster, so I figured it would go both ways. And then, yeah, the dress just because it was very conservative and very like her.
Okay, and then my second question is, with everything that you learned through your research and on your topic, What significance was it to you?
The prohibition to me?
Mm-hmm.
It was like, oh, how? I don't even know.
Well, what lesson did you learn from that? Maybe that would be a good way of phrasing it.
What lesson did I learn about what America learned?
Through the prohibition.
I kind of learned that sometimes we pass laws with good intentions, but we just can't pull it off. We have this great idea, but it just doesn't work out sometimes. I've kind of learned that through this whole thing. I've had times like that where I have this great idea, and when I try to put it into action, it fails. So I kind of learned that it would be trial and error, I guess.
Thank you.
When you were researching your characters, Carrie Nation and Malcolm, what resources did you find the most helpful?
I use the internet a lot as far as, you mean like a specific source or just a general?
Just general.
The internet was very helpful because I could just type in, you know, Al Capone, and if I found something interesting, I could just type that in, and it could lead me to very many places, so that was very useful. And I had a few books that I used, not any that I would like, but those were definitely useful as well.
Thank you.
What's the most important idea that you'd like the audience to take away from your presentation?
About the prohibition?
About your, all the things that you talked about in your presentation. What's, to you, just what's the most important?
I guess the most important thing to me would be that we have gone through a lot as a country, I guess, that we actually had alcohol banned at a time would be kind of important to me. That I didn't even know that when I started. My mom suggested the prohibition, and I looked at her like she was crazy. So I think that's very important to know, is that it was once banned and that we've moved on from that now.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.